introduction, guys. Hi, I'm Abhishek. I'm the creator of Remote Indian Community. And what we try to do here with these weekly sessions is just a ritual to engage with the community, to talk about topics which have some overlap with remote working here. And today, it's my pleasure to have Swapnil and Avi here. Swapnil, Avi, can you guys do like a quick intro of yourselves while people are joining in?
Sure, I'll go first. Hey everyone, my name is Swapnil. I worked as a software developer for a couple of years before moving to a product management role. And right now I run a startup with the aim of fixing tech hiring at scale. And I've been journaling for around like 6 years now. So happy to be here to share my experience.
And I can go next. So hey everyone, I am Avi. And I am currently software developer at a US company. And I have been journaling for the last 3 years now. I started journaling just to experiment and record my thoughts. But over time, I think journaling has given me a lot of value. And that is what I'm looking to share here.
Awesome, guys. Thank you for that quick intro. So the plan for, you know, today's session, I've already, you know, shared a doc. So some of you might have seen that Google Doc. So the first half of the hour, we are going to, you know, discuss what is the value of, journaling. I love to, you know, have this quote in mind, which says that an unexamined life is not worth living. And this is by Socrates. So we'll dive into the why behind, you know, journaling, and then the later half of the session, we are going into more tactical kind of stuff, and maybe we'll also have an exercise for you. So that should be, you know, interesting. And we'll share what are the tools that we're using, which work for us, which don't, and maybe some caveats which come along with it. Yeah. So I see 20 people join in. So I think, you know, this should be considered quorum for now. I would extend a warm welcome to, you know, all of the people who have joined in, and yeah, hope you have, you know, a good time listening in, and please feel free to use the Q&A tab, you know, whenever you have a question that comes up, we'll take them up at the end of the session. Yep. So Swapnil, maybe you want to, you know, kick off this session with a quick, you know, intro about why journaling? I think that's the question which we want to, you know, kick off this discussion with.
Yeah. Sure. So it happened in a very interesting way. So I was in my second year of college, and I had recently went to Hyderabad for some kind of event. And when I came back, I was like, okay, this was a good change of pace in my life right now. And I met a lot of new people there, and it was refreshing. And somehow it hit me that, you know, I might not remember it down the line. This thought got triggered from one of my previous week's thought, which was along the lines of if you remember Beyblade, if you played that in your childhood, so that was a very, you know, different period in our lives when, you know, just came home and just played Beyblade. And right now I don't remember much of it. I just remember it as a, you know, a good time. That's all I remember now. So I thought, okay, now I'm forgetting stuff because of, you know, as and when new experiences come in, I don't remember a lot of these stuff. So that's how I started journaling. I just randomly took out, like, I think I used to use Evernote at the moment. So I just, you know, wrote down my day's details on that. And pretty much that was the start. And my second entry was like a few months down the line. But then when I wrote my second entry and accidentally reread my first one, I was like surprised by how much I forgot within the 6 months of that event. I was like, oh, this is... Okay, this is something that, you know, I'm missing out, and that's the whole story about how I got started. Yeah.
Awesome. So Apnil, is that, you know, like the, like, you know, I think this is like a perfect segue to, you know, talk about like the idea that you shared in one of your YouTube videos, which is screenshot your mind. Is that, you know, like what you, you know, think about when you like, you know, when you, when, yep, sorry.
Yeah. So that's exactly like now, whenever I, you know, try to explain anyone about the benefits of journaling, I start with this analogy. Hey, whenever something good is happening, let's say you're going on a vacation or, you know, anywhere new, what do you do? You know, like instinctively, what do? You just take out your phone and snap a picture of it. And you do that because you want to preserve that moment, right? It's, you can, you know, rationalize it all you want. Ki, hey, I'm doing it for social validation or whatnot. But deep down, you know, ki, hey, you want to see that picture again and, you know, feel the way you did when you took that picture. So that's definitely the analogy I give. And then a segue into like going deeper into that is ki, a picture, however, like, you know, even though it conveys 1,000 words, but then it does not describe your state of mind. It more, you know, it more talks about ki, hey, it just captures some sense of where you were, but not exactly what was going on at that point, you know, in your mind. So definitely these are sort of, you know, the ideas ki, huh, if you are experiencing something new, you're already taking pictures of it. So why not take a screenshot of your mind as well?
Nice. Yeah, I really like that, you know, metaphor that you have used. Avi, what are, you know, like, in your experience, what have been the benefits of journaling? Any, you know, examples that you would like to, you know, share from your life?
Yeah. So very similar to Swapnil, I also started journaling because I wanted to preserve my memories. So it so happened that I was in a hackathon that I was working very hard in. I coded for like 36 hours nonstop, but we still lost it. So I was feeling very down and very sad after that day. But I was feeling so sad that I wanted to record it so that I can compare it to my state 2 days later, so that if it even makes sense to be that kind of sad. So that is how I got started. But most recently, like in the last 2-3 years, the major benefit that I am seeing of journaling is that it helps me to defrag my mind. So let's suppose that you're not sure what to do in your career, or what kind of business do you want to do, or should you invest in this company or cryptocurrency or not. So when you are trying to make that kind of decision, you have a lot of thoughts in your brain and they are very jumbled. And when you are trying to put them together in your brain, you're not able to, because like our brain has limited capacity, or maybe we get confused. But when you journal it, when you write it down, then all the thoughts that are in your brain come to the paper, and now you can arrange it physically as you want. And I think, and I have noticed that it helps me a lot to make decisions and understand what is going on inside the brain better. So I will say that has been the biggest benefit for me.
Okay, cool. So defragging your mind, as in like it's a very, you know, interesting, like a very nerdy term to use, right? And could you elaborate on that? Like how does journaling help you to, you know, defrag mind and stuff?
Right. So the word defrag, I think it became popular because, I'm not sure why it became popular, but defragging essentially means that you have bits of data that are all over the place and you want to put them together in close proximity to one another so that it is more efficient. At least this is what defrag means in computer terms. But in case of our mind, like we have a lot of data, like let's take an example of should you quit your job or should you do a business? So suppose you listen to the podcast by Naval, where he says that you should not have a job and do a business with specific knowledge and like some stuff. And then you also read an article about in Medium where it says that the salaries of employees in big tech companies are this much, which are very impressive. And now you are not sure how to compare these two. And similarly, like this, you might have another variables like that you have noticed. Like suppose you have a friend that will get you into Google because he will give you a good referral, plus he will train you for the interview. So you have all these variables in your mind and you don't know how to compare them so that you can come to a final decision. I have found that it is very hard to come to a decision while you are still in your mind trying to compute it internally. So when you write everything down on paper, like I am thinking of joining Google, but then I won't be able to start a business because this, I want to do business because this. So when you do all that, then a lot of the facts come from your brain to the paper, and it helps you see a more complete picture of the entire decision tree, if I may. So let's suppose you want to decide if you want to take a job at Google or not, then there may be like hundreds of different data points that might influence that decision, hundreds of different facts. But if you put the major ones of them on the paper, then you can see all of them at once in front of your eyes and you can connect them to come to a decision better. I hope it makes sense because yeah. I think I went went into a very advanced topic.
I think no, it's okay. Like I'll make sure that we, you know, don't go too much into tangents. And just to add to what you said, I feel that, you know, a lot of the decisions that we need to take are very personal, right?
Right.
And it's not like you can just do like a Google search that, hey, Google, tell me, like, do you feel it's a good idea to join Google or not? There's so many, you know, variables which are just, you know, important for us, like values or any other, you know, decisions which come into picture. So that's one thing which, you know, I wanted to add. And the other bit would be, you know, to talk a little bit about the idea of, you know, thinking in third person view. I feel like what writing or what journaling allows us to do, or putting our thoughts on paper allows us to do, is putting some distance between, you know, like what is going inside our head and, you know, the person that we are. So I feel that's another, you know, benefit which comes into picture, that you're not very attached, or you're not, you know, I would say like it's some form of meditation, to put it in simple terms. Yeah,
I think it also helps, you know, like you said, Keith, when you have put your thoughts on paper, it also becomes very easy to discuss. In this case, if you are discussing the reasons for joining some place or not, when you put your thoughts concretely on paper, you can actually discuss those points with your friends, right? Because then those points are like objective, versus when you are just talking without any concrete substance, then you are saying something when you're talking, but then you have a lot of baggage in your mind as well, and which is not really visible to the other person. So all those discussions which you are having without, like, you know, having your pros and cons written down concretely, it's mostly, you know, you're doing what you want. You're not actually listening to the other person because you're passing the other person's advice through a filter of your baggage, which is sort of very subjective.
Cool, man.
So I would also like to add, since we are on the topic of decision making, key, of course, it makes perfect sense to, you know, do or make decisions by writing your thoughts on paper, but it's also very beneficial years down the line when you are in a post-rationalization mode. So, like, let's say you took a decision of joining a particular company or not, and you have written those down. When you look at this decision a couple of years down the line, it's very easy to, you know, to see why you made that decision. Otherwise, you'll always be in that loop, ki, hey, you know, I don't know why I did that. You're not going to remember. You're making thousands of decisions every year, right? Or maybe micro decisions every year. You're not going to remember why or which particular point tipped you into making a particular decision. And so, like, well, like you say, right? Ki, hey, Bitcoin is rising. If only I had invested back then. If only I held on to back then. But you have a very, if you have a very clear reason of, you know, writing, ki, hey, I invested in Bitcoin. It got the valuation or the price got raised to 4x. And I feel it's a safe, you know, returns. And these are the reasons why I'm taking it out. So then you can, like, you know, this is for your future self. Ki, hey, this is what my current state of mind was. And this is why I made this decision. And of course, you obviously want to make the best decision with the knowledge you have. So I think journaling is a very useful, or, you know, it's very useful for your future self.
Cool. So I want to, you know, shift the conversation a little bit, you know, in a different direction now, as in, like, this clear movement where we are, you know, publishing a lot of work right now, like, obviously this build in public, and you can, you know, take that same example where you can write in public. So I'm just curious whether, you know, journaling is a way to, you know, create, is that a part of your creation process, or is it just for, you know, your intrinsic value? I think that is something which maybe, you know, like, it's obviously, you know, a doubt which I have. And I guess there might be somebody in the audience who might be thinking the same, that, hey, Swapnil, how many of, you know, your journal entries actually do they, you know, get published on the internet, or they don't need to be? I think, yeah.
I think it's interesting. It's less than 5%. So, like, most of my thoughts are for, like, private use only. And it's more so because, you know, journaling is very, very personal. And most of the things that you are thinking or doing,
yeah,
not really helpful to the other person unless you have made sure to, you know, remove all of your biases and any particular events for, like, that happened to you. So I would say, like, it's very, the percentage of posts that come out of my journal, like, very, very less, like, less than 5% for sure. Did we actually launch?
So no pressure. No, man, I think we conveniently forgot about it. So just a, you know, quick break of sorts, wherein we want to, you know, figure out how many of you have already, you know, comfortable with this idea of journaling. So if you can see now, there's a poll which is going to show up. So we'd like to know, you know, Swapnil, yep, as, can you see the results?
Yep.
Avi, I hope you can see as well. Yeah.
I'm surprised, like, the majority of people have already journaled before. So I'm just curious.
No, I feel, you know, like, it's a very, you know, it's a stepping stone to, I would say, a lot of career growth or any lot of things, but yeah. So I think, you know, I'm going to end this poll, and I hope, you know, the audience can see it. And Swapnil, maybe you want to take this discussion now to a different point, about, you know, what are the other benefits of journaling, and
you can give me a minute.
Yep. Cool. So Avi, and, you know, while Swapnil is out, I think I'd like to, you know, talk a little bit about planning your goals and things around that. So how important is journaling in this particular, you know, scheme of things, that, you know, do you use the idea of journaling to?
Yeah, that's a very good question. I think there are two very distinct ways in which journaling helps with respect to goals. The first way is like introspection. If you are journaling a lot, and if you have been journaling for a like few months, you will get to a point where you will know yourself much better than before. And if you are at that stage, then of course the goals that you set for yourself will be much more meaningful to you. Like, for some people, working a job at a popular company might be a great goal, but if they do some introspection, they will realize that, suppose, like, in reality, they just want to do their own thing and be like decently paid with it so that they can make a living and keep doing their own thing. So I think if you are journaling, then you are improving, you are introspecting, and with introspections, you are making better goals for yourself, which in turn means that if you achieve them, you will be more happy. So that's one point. Then second point is something that I discovered only last year, which is if you like even like mention your goals in the journal, like let's suppose it is January 12, 2020 today, and you mention that I think I can get really fit this year because I have all the time. Getting fit only requires 2 months for me based on my current physique, and I think I can really do that. It will be nice to do that. But now suppose you waste entire year and you didn't get fit, so in that case you will have a clear record of your intention back on January 14, 2020. Now 1 year has passed and you clearly failed on your goal, so it also keeps you accountable in a very private sort of way. Like there is one thing called public accountability where you put a tweet or say to your friend. So that's public accountability. Maybe like some people might not want to do that because then you will have to share your goals with others and maybe your goals are private and you don't want to share it with them. But with journaling, you can get some sort of a private accountability. And the more you do it, the more you set your goals in journal and then see and reflect back on them, you will realize that you're not as good of a goal getter as you are. And it will improve your like goal getting process going forward.
Cool. Swapnil, you want to jump in with any thoughts on goal setting and journaling? Like, is there any overlap between the two?
So I started out with like tracking goals in my journal, but it didn't really work out well for me because like Avi mentioned, right? You get a clearer picture of, where you stand. You say, hey, you'll do these 5 things. But when you reflect back, you have done only 2 or 3 things. So then it really, makes you think, hey, maybe I'm not, so good or like whatever. It started making me feel bad for myself. So now, like right now, how I've done is I've separated goal tracking to like from journaling entirely. Like for me right now, journaling is just sort of sharing my thoughts of what's happening or what I'm feeling versus tracking goals is a like totally different thing for me right now. Because then if I associate them, if I'm not doing good in my goals, then I don't really, like picking up my journal to write in it. So that sort of didn't work out for me.
So from what I heard, Swapnil, you're saying that sometimes, you have that fear of like being too much, how do I phrase this? Like you want to show yourself the mirror, but you don't want to, make yourself bad as well. So in that sense,
yeah. So I think
that's where there's a separation of concerns.
There's a fine line here. Ki, you want to push yourself, and that's why tracking is important, because you always want to, you never want to say, hey, I planned for this and I achieved this, because then maybe you're missing out on your potential. So there's always that fear. But then there's also this key when you are actually tracking your goals. And if you don't end up, maybe you end up doing 20% of them. So how does that affect you? And I think it depends a lot on person to person on how they take a certain success percentage. I think it's very personal. Some might think, hey, 20% is very good because they have set the goal so high. Some might say, hey, 20%, I thought I would have done like 90%. And since I actually end up doing 20%, then maybe something's really wrong with me. So I say that that fine line is really, something that everyone has to figure out for themselves.
Yeah.
We say, right, the Goldilocks spot.
Yeah. And maybe, a lot of the value is in the intangible bits. Like we like to, check our metrics. We like to, see how many likes we got and things like that, you know, where we stand in terms of goals. But maybe, you know, like that's what we are trying to hint at, is that journaling allows you to tap into those intangible, you know, value creation processes, which is like, you know, not generally talked about that much. And maybe we just want to, you know, like round up this discussion by talking a little bit about, you know, building your emotional database. I think that's a very interesting point that we have on the list of, you know, benefits of journaling. So anyone who wants to, you know, take a jab at it, Swapnil, you know, like what do you mean when you know, think about that perspective?
Sure. Yeah. So it again ties up with, you know, taking random screenshots of your mind. And once you have done or taken a lot of those screenshots, you have a lot of data on yourself, which you wouldn't have had if you had, you know, not journaled, because it's realistically not possible that, you know, you remember everything unless you have a photographic memory. So I think it this is, for example, when I see my journal entries from, like, you know, 5 years back, then I can clearly see how my thought process has evolved, and, you know, what were the kind of emotions that I used to feel back then versus how do I tackle things right now. So for example, like I made a hard decision of quitting a very early stage startup around 4 years back, and the way that I dealt with that emotionally versus how I would deal with it now, that clearly reflects in my journal. Ki, hey, you know, it's very personal, you know, saying what kind of, you know, emotions do you evolve over time. I think that's a very interesting area. Yeah.
So Swapnil of 2017 is, you know, very different from Swapnil in 2021, and seeing that change, I think that's the value of journaling. Is that?
Yep, I think you nailed it. Yeah.
Awesome. And one thing I would like to add on the same topic is, I can like very much relate with Swapnil on this topic. I was recently going through my journals of 2018, and I noticed that when I'm recording events in 2018, there is very less emotional depth on the situation of the event. So for example, suppose I failed at something. So I just say that I failed at something, so I suck. But in 2020, the same journal will have a lot of emotional reasons why this happened. Like, okay, so that moment I got complacent. Then I had this fear about that thing, which is unreal. And the reason it is unreal is because data. So your emotional depth increases as you journal, because you learn about exploring your emotionality more and more with every journal entry. And like, if you do a journal like only 5 times, you won't see any difference. But if you do it like consistently for some years, there will be a very noticeable difference. And you can refer back to your old journal entries to find that.
Very nice. So I think we'd like to, you know, end on that particular note. Like, I hope we have been able to, you know, sell you this idea that why journaling is important. And I feel a lot of it is very internal, as in like don't, you know, like we are not the experts here for sure. And we are just trying to normalize this idea of journaling. And that's the idea of the session. So now I would like to, you know, switch gears a little bit, wherein we talk more about the actionable bits. But before that, Swapnil, do you think, you know, we should get the audience to do like a quick exercise?
Yep.
What do you think?
I think theory is sort of endless. We can go on like hours and hours on this, but what I want everyone to do right now is we'll give you a prompt and like take a few minutes, maybe 4 or 5 minutes, and think it would be great if everyone does that, writes your thoughts on those, on that prompt. So I'm pasting that prompt in the chat. How do I do that? Okay.
Do you need some help?
No. Yeah. Yep. So the prompt for you is, like, try to remember any particular moment from your past and write down as many details about that event as you can. And the importance of this is keep the number of details, the amount of details that you would remember right now versus if you try to remember that moment a few years down the line, that's going to be very different. So this is the best time for you to sort of, you know, mummify or preserve that moment. So yeah, I'd really love for everyone to take 5 minutes and just write down as many details as you can about your favorite moment from the past. Just pick a old TXT file and, you know, just do that. Let's do that.
Awesome. So in the meanwhile, what do we do? Should we play some music?
Yep, I think that's a great idea.
Okay, let me try to see. I hope I can, you know, play some before the time ends. So I think, you know, the idea is to just, you know, get you into this habit. I know for sure that a lot of people are already, you know, in the habit of journaling, but we just wanted to, you know, have a sort of a exercise in between all of this gyan of sorts, yeah. Swapnil, can you confirm that you hear something?
Good with, and I just like come.
So welcome back, everyone. So I see, you know, like Bharat sharing a quick, you know, reflection on this. And I'd like to, you know, be mindful that, you know, some of these things that you're writing is very, you know, personal. But just a quick thumbs up from, you know, everybody that, hey, this is something which you're comfortable doing, or, you know, or maybe, you know, Swapnil, does that work? I cannot figure out the poll bit right now.
Achha.
It's too you much can happening.
Just, like, drop a emoji in the chat if you just remembered or like just followed the prompt. So you just want to see what state are people in. Are you following? Do you need more push?
Yep. Okay. See some thumbs up there.
Cool. So I see a lot of questions. Do you want to quickly take these Q&As?
I feel, you know, let's complete, you know, the plan that we have in mind, and then we can, you know, take those questions. Like I hope it's okay if we, you know, extend beyond the hour, right?
Yep.
Swapnil and Avi.
Yeah.
Yep. So we'll take those questions, you know, for sure. But let's kind of, you know, switch gears a little bit and talk a little bit about, you know, the actionable parts of journaling. Like, so the obvious question, you know, like people have is, hey, Swapnil, or hey, Avi, what is the, you know, tool that you're using? And that's the question maybe, you know, we're going to start off this second half of this session right now. Swapnil, any,
sure.
What's your de facto, you know, tool?
Yeah, so I tried a bunch of tools. I tried Evernote, I tried OneNote, I like followed bullet journal for like 2 years. Right now, my de facto, like the tool of choice is Day One, because it has a really nice UI, first of all, and then it's in Markdown. Like you can write in Markdown, and it also has these writing prompts. I think this is my biggest deal maker. Like you know, like we saw a lot of people who, you know, followed the prompt just now. So it's more like, you know, if you have good prompts incoming, it becomes, you know, way easier to write. So that's why I mainly use Day One as of now.
Awesome. Avi, what about you?
Yeah, so I use Evernote. And the primary reason for that is I use Evernote as my note-taking app. So I think, like, if you are using Notion or Rome Research or any other note-taking app, you can also use them for journaling. You don't need to be super concerned if you are using the right app for journaling or not. But if, like, suppose you are using some note-taking app and it doesn't work for you for journaling, I would recommend that you try Day One, because as Swapnil said, it has a very nice UI. It is very pleasant to write in, and it has a lot of features. So try that as well.
I suppose, you know, Day One is specifically made for the, you know, purpose
journaling.
Of journaling.
Like, yes.
This particular features which are there. So before I bring in like a member from the audience who wants to, you know, talk about his process, I maybe want to quickly talk about the benefits of, you know, using a digital tool. Like why do you, you know, use a digital tool rather than, you know, using something analog? And yeah, because that's something which, you know, crops up, right?
I think Swapnil, the biggest benefit of that is privacy.
Sorry.
If you have something, and so journaling gets a lot of value because you are sharing your internal thoughts that you won't share it with anyone else. It's, as Swapnil said, it is basically like a snapshot of your brain. And like, we can all agree that we don't want to open source our brain and say everything that is inside our brain to everyone else. Definitely not. So if you are using a physical notebook, there will always be a risk that someone will take it and read it. So if instead, if you are using a end-to-end encrypted digital notebook, then there is no such risk. And I think that will help. That helps in journaling a lot, because now you can go deep inside your brain, write things that you will never ever say in public, and that holds a lot of value for you.
So one more deal maker for the digital tooling that I use is it provides like cross-platform support between your mobile and, you know, desktop. So it's very easy to, you know, journal when you are mobile, and even like you come back on your laptop and you can, like, you know, refine that thought later. So that's also one of the reasons. And then again, like when you have built you know, a larger database, it also gives you quick access to, like, you basically can search and like tag entries. So like those are my reasons for going digital.
So Anurag, I hope that was the perfect setup to bring you in.
Yes, absolutely.
So Anurag here, you know, he's using a bullet journal, which is an analog way of, you know, journaling. And that's why, you know, I wanted to get his thoughts as well, because for some of you, maybe, you know, writing it down in a physical notebook makes sense. And Anurag wants to, you know, vouch for that. Anurag.
Yeah, absolutely. Can you hear me?
Yep.
Okay, awesome. So like these guys, right? So maybe 2-3 years ago, that was the time of my life where I thought things are moving at a pace that I'm comfortable in. And I wanted to capture my thoughts, right? So like everybody, I started with, you could say, digital processes. So I have tried Notion, I have tried Rome Research, I have tried Evernote. So basically, even there is this one application called as Bytebase. Okay, so it mimics Vim, like you could say, the way you use Vim, you can use that particular note taking tool, right? So there are multiple tools that are coming into the market, and I've tried them. But then ultimately, it came when it came COVID times. There was this idea or a reflection that I'm spending way lot time on screens. So I'm staring the screen like 24 hours a day, and which is not healthy, to be very honest. Not I mean, we everybody know. So that is where I started to pick up a physical, you could say, notebook, and that is what I have stuck to from last 6 or 8 months approximately. So I'm not very, you could say, expert in writing these things, but it is working for me so far. So why did I choose notebook? So one thing is I wanted to make sure that I'm not running away from writing. There are multiple peoples online who vouch for writing. So I read a few books last year, which changed my perspective about writing, following Tim Ferriss. If you listen to chats from Naval and all that stuff, right? They say that, okay, you should do it. Now, coming to the actual point, why I chose bullet journal, right? So there are certain questions that I just glanced through when I was chatting here. So everybody or most of the people in software industry start their day with a to-do list. But the problem with the to-do list is it's ephemeral, or basically you just throw it away once your day is done. Or basically, it is not structured or less structured. What bullet journal brings to the table is a way of short form, quick capture writing thing, right? So when we are looking at general, journaling thing, people get blank heads. I used to sit with a pen and a paper, or opening a Notion and try to capture how the day was, but then I could not do it, right? So the point of entry or sometimes the writer's block was a little huge. So in order to overcome that, I started bullet journaling. So typically what I do is when I start the day, I'll bring up my notebook, and I have mixed this particular, you could say, method from multiple sources. I'll just let you know that. But I'm following the original bullet journal, you could say, author's method. His name is Ryder Carroll, or Carroll Ryder. He has written a book as well about bullet journaling altogether. But the method is very simple. At the beginning of the day, you start by listing down your tasks. So if it is a task, give it a dot. If it is an event, give it a circle. And if you just want to write some notes, scribble something, right? give it a dash and scribble whatever you want to do. But this method should not take, or this particular process should not take more than 5 to 10 minutes. Now, by doing that, what you're doing is you're creating a brain dump of what you have in your mind in the morning. Your all tasks are on paper, and you can then just go about your day. Now, because this particular page has tasks, events, and even notes, if you just follow that particular video, you'll come to know that you will be in a position that, okay, let's say every fortnight or every month, you decide to go over to check how the month was. Then you can start crossing out the basically the task that you wanted to do. And if they are complete, you just scratch them out. If you're not doing it, scratch them out. If they are done, just tick mark them. And what it will do is you can then forward them to the next month, next week, or you can put them back you could say, a to-do task, a master to-do list. So to understand that, just follow Carol Ryder's 10-minute video on YouTube. I'll put that link in the chat. And that will basically get you started. It is a low, what I think is bullet journaling is a lower point of entry for people who want to collect their thoughts. And in that process, basically become a little more mindful of how they're using their time. And once you, once you are mindful about spending your time, then, and once you start the enjoying the process of writing, your short form writing may and will convert to long form writing, where at the end of the day, you might either collect your thoughts of how you feel the day, or the next day you will start writing what people call as morning pages. So
yeah,
the reason why I push bullet journaling is because it's easier to get started, and then you can grow from there at your own pace.
Yep. So from, you know, from what I understood, you know, asking this question to each one of you, there's no one way of, you know, doing this. I would, you know, ask everyone to focus more on the prompts, or, you know, like the questions that you want to, you know, think about or reflect. I think the tool in its essence doesn't matter in the end. Like, you can choose a tool which works for you. It can be simple pen and paper. It could be as, you know, interesting as day one. So that's the caveat which I'd like to, you know, maybe add to this particular, you know, thing that we have. And I have like a couple of templates which I'll, you know, maybe share later in the group. I'm not going to, you know, do this right now because it could be, you know, overwhelming. Like, there are like a lot of questions there, and it's very structured in that sense. But at the end of the session, I can, you know, send those links to you. And Anurag, we can also, you know, add the video that you're mentioning about bullet journal. Yeah. So thanks a lot, Anurag. And Swapnil, any closing thoughts on this particular, you know, section that we have before we move to the Q&A section about, you know, tools and templates and stuff?
Sure. So I always see tools as a way to optimize for something. Tools can never be, you know, the foundation level. Like, for example, in this case, we're talking about journaling. So you can't say, hey, we'll only start when we have a particular tool with us, or, you know, when we have everything set up. Tools come in picture based on your sort of, you know, problems, or like the issues that you're facing without the tool. So for example, I think for journaling, the best way to get started with is simple TXT files, or, you know, maybe the Notes app on your computer or your mobile, and write down maybe, you know, at least 10 entries, 15 entries. Then you'll start to feel the problems that you are facing. Then you'll see for yourself, hey, does encryption or does password prediction matter to you? Then you'll have a list of, you know, such things, that the issues that you're facing. And based on that, you decide on the tool. And it could be a physical tool, it could be a digital tool. But then, my advice is, you know, first face those problems, and then go for the tool.
Avi, any closing thoughts? And I just quickly checked. I want to, you know, talk a little bit about morning pages before we move to the Q&A. Yeah.
Okay.
Avi, any thoughts before?
Yeah. So in journaling, the content matters more than the tool. Like it's what you write in your journal is more important than the tool. So I would, I 100% agree that first you need to get started using any means that is available to you and that you like. And like, as you start doing that, you will notice the features that you want. And like, you will start looking for apps or templates that can incorporate that.
Yeah, I think Notion is obviously, you know, like the leader in this space, like in terms of templates. Like I'm sure if you Google Notion journal templates, you'll find, you know, like really, really, you know, nice ones. And I'd say the same thing for Roam as well. So before we, you know, move to the Q&A section, and I really want to be mindful of everybody's time here. And that's why, you know, but at the same time, we want to pack as much information as possible into this webinar that we're doing. So I want to quickly talk about morning pages, which is a very unstructured way of, you know, journaling. Like you don't have any particular questions in mind. It's just you're trying to, you know, write everything that is on your mind right now. And using those thoughts, you can drill down deeper and kind of, you know, so I feel the idea of morning pages is a way of, you know, just cleaning up your RAM of sorts. Like, you know, you just want to make sure that your memory is really cleaned up so that you can focus on the work, which is, you know, the work which is important for you. And it, I from what I felt like, I've been using Evernote a lot, but recently, because of, you know, a lot of I would say this I'm going through an emotional roller coaster right now, and I feel having those prompts is actually limiting in a weird way. Like when I'm like in the mood to, you know, really like I'm in a positive frame of mind, I feel some bit of structure helps. But when things are going a little bit tougher, I feel that, you know, having these, having no boundaries or having no such questions as such, I feel helps me to get over the emotional, you know, thing that I'm going through right now. So that's quick, you know, word on morning pages. And I really, you know, feel that this session we are trying to, you know, talk about a lot of things. So what we promise you is that, you know, any questions that you have, we'll, you know, we can take them up after the session. Like, you know, I just want to be mindful of everybody's time here. So that's why I'm cutting short. So I would, you know, now try to look at the questions, and there is a lot of them. Swapnil, Avi, can you see them as well?
Yep.
So let's just quickly, you know, wrap up the session by doing like a Q&A of sorts. And the first question obviously is, you know, tool based. any answers for, you know, any open source self-hosted journaling tools?
So one I have found for that is called Joplin. I will also write it here. It is cross-platform. It is open source. It is self-hosted. So try it. Maybe it will work.
Cool. Swapnil, any?
No.
I am also not, you know, aware of an open source tool, but Avi, I think, you know, I guess you mentioned it in the Q&A tab, right?
Joplin is very much like Evernote, but open source and self-hosted. So you can definitely use it for journaling. I think it has templates as well. So you can, when you get advanced, you can create your own templates and do it daily and all that.
So Akash has a question. wherein he mentions that how do you maintain the habit of journaling? Like he has started it many times, but failed to keep at it. And WebV has the same, you know, conundrum of sorts. Yeah.
So the cliched answer is, you know, like, you know, make it so easy that you can't say no to. So like, maybe have a prompt that, you know, you can answer in, let's say, 5 words or less. Something like, you know, maybe, how are you feeling today? At the end of the day, if you have this prompt, how are you feeling right now? So I think the hard part is to actually start. And once you have started with writing a journal entry, things sort of flows. On maybe doing it daily, in regards to that, I don't do that daily anymore. I've set sort of like an internal maybe calibration for myself, what kind of things I want to note down in my journal. So sometimes it happens that, you know, 10 days go by and I have nothing written in my journal. Sometimes I have 3 entries in one day itself. So it's more, so for me, it has more become, ki, hey, what kind of things do I want to preserve instead of, you know, trying to do it regularly.
So I would kind of summarize it by saying, like, you know, don't worry too much about doing it every day, like, and don't do premature optimization.
I would like to, like, you know, add a very good analogy here. I'm assuming most of us are developers here, right?
Yep.
So think of journaling as commits. So what commits allow you to do is go back to a specific point of time, right? So now when you're using version control, you already know as developers ki 3 commits are better than 1, 10 commits are better than 3, 100 commits are better than 50. And even 1 commit is better than not using version control at all. So I would say the benefits are, you know, compared to something like fitness, wherein you have to invest time on a regular basis to be able to continue reaping those outputs. Journaling does not go into that, you know, marginal returns, like diminishing marginal return space. Whatever time you have already invested, you'll get the returns definitely. So I think don't worry about, you know, doing it regularly for now. Whatever time you invest, I can assure you, you'll get the, like, you know, part of it.
Cool. So, and just, you know, moving quickly through these.
And can I add something to the previous question? So
yep.
There is a tool that I use called Dailyo, Dailyio. So it is a visual journaling app, which sends you a notification every day. And it will ask you like what you did today. Did you exercise? Did you walk? Did you study? Did you work? So it is a very low, it is probably the lowest friction way to something to journal. So you can install that app from Play Store or App Store and try using it. It is not proper journaling because you're not writing any words, but it will get you into a habit of recording your emotions every day. And maybe that can lead you into proper journaling, like written down journaling. And another insight that I would like to add is people have different kind of interests. So suppose you are someone who has not much interest in talking about the day-to-day mundane things that you do. Like today you ate ice cream or went to this movie. Maybe you don't want to write about it. It is quite non-interesting to you. But maybe you are very interested in stock market or politics or cricket, even cricket. So each of us has something that we are very interested about. And I think that if you just journal about the thing that you are very interested in starting, then you can pick up that habit. So suppose like these days I am very interested in cryptocurrency trading. So every day I journal about the trades that I write, the trades that I do, like I bought this token at this price. The reason I bought is because this. And if the trade goes wrong, I will write about like, why does this go wrong? What did I miss? So I think if you just narrow the scope down of the journal to the thing that you are very interested in and that you do daily, then it will help you pick some habit of journaling. And then maybe hopefully you can expand to other topics.
Yep. That's a fair point. And just to add, I think I've heard people keep developer logs. Like, you know, they would just keep a log of, you know, like as a programmer, you deal with interesting problems in work, right? So journaling about them is also like a good way to keep a history of the work that you're doing. And the side benefit is that, you know, when there's a review which needs to happen 6 months from now, you don't need to, you know, like be worried. You already have that information with you. So moving, you know, quickly now, I think there's a lot of things to talk about. And I would maybe, you know, Webby's question about the frequency of different types of journaling. Maybe Swapnil, you could quickly answer that. I feel we have answered it to some degree, but maybe we can just, you know. I'm sorry, you're on mute. Yep.
So like I don't have a frequency set. I tried doing that, but then what happened is like, you know, if I miss some time, it snowballs really fast, you know. So like when you are on a streak, it has both pros and cons. Pros is key, you have momentum going on, but then the con is key, if you lose that streak, you lose every motivation to, you know, sort of continue doing that on your next day. So so for now, I'm like not doing it at a particular frequency.
But try doing it daily, I would say. Just, you know, suggest you to, you know, try that. Like if you can do it daily, great. If you can't, that's cool as well. That's perfectly okay. Next question is from Madan, wherein he says, this is a very interesting question, as in like, how often do you go back and refer to your, you know, old notes? Or is this just a, you know, dumping ground for, you know, whatever is going in your head right now? Avi, you want to take a stab at it?
Yeah. So last year I started this habit where at the end of every month, I will go back to the previous month journal and read through it again. But first I found out that it took a lot of time. It took around 3 hours to read the entire month's journal. So that was a pain. And I find that it doesn't give me much benefit. Like if you do it on a periodic basis, I find that it doesn't give me much benefit. But if you do it on a very spontaneous basis, like suppose you're feeling down today, or suppose you feel like going back to the journal and reading back those 2019 entries, then you should do so. So my answer will be like, do what you want and when you want.
Yep. Swapnil, what about you? Anything you'd like to add to it?
Yeah, so I would say like I've referenced it quite a bit. It's mostly when like I want to make a new decision right now. So it helps me to sort of refer to previous decisions and what was the thought process that went into making those. And also it gives a good calibration of things that, you know, let's say you're anticipating some good thing to happen. So the feeling that, you know, the mindset that you're in before that happens. So a journal entry before that. And once you've already, maybe that thing happened and like do a journal entry after that. So that gives me a good calibration of, you know, how to expect a similar thing in future. I'm not sure if I'm making sense.
Yeah, I've never tried that, but it's an interesting thought. And, you know,
so it's, okay, like let me give an example. So let's say you're going on a trip, right? You're going out on a 5 day a week vacation. Now, there's a period where you're anticipating going for that. And, you know, you're feeling something, maybe you're anticipating your trip and you're feeling good. And once you're back from the trip, or when you're actually in the trip, there's some other feelings that you go through. And once you're back, maybe you feel down again, or like it's very personal, but yeah, there are different kinds of feelings, right? So now capturing those, it helps me see if I do a similar event again, what is the expectation ki hai? It looks like this on the face value, but actually when I, you know, go through the entire ordeal again, how does that affect me? Like replace the trip example with like any generic event.
And just to, you know, complete Swapnil, Madan's question, wherein he says, do you folks tag your entries? I think you can do a lot of interesting things. I think day one allows it, and Rome is like really crazy. If you want to go down that rabbit hole, you know, feel free to do so. But again, the caveat is, the disclaimer, clear disclaimer is, please, you know, don't do premature optimization. Like, just focus on writing and just, you know, letting your thoughts out. Akash's question is another, you know, interesting one, wherein he says, how do you avoid the trap of your journal being an echo chamber for you? Is that, you know, something that you're trying to, you know, be mindful about, like, to avoid, you know, biases in your decision making and things like that?
I'm thinking that I have also noticed in my journaling experience that for a moment of time, my journal becomes an echo chamber where I am talking about the same thing again and again. Now, like, there are two types of echo chambers. Suppose there is an echo chamber which is actually uplifting you. You are thinking some kind of positive thoughts and it is causing a positive change in your life. So you don't want that echo chamber to go away in a way, because that's a desirable one. But suppose now you have a negative echo chamber where you are thinking about some person or something in a very incorrect way. And then again, you want to cut your losses. You don't want to keep thinking about that person or that event like that for your entire life. So I think what helps here is being very honest with yourself. If you are honest with yourself and if you keep journaling every day, then at one point you will realize that you have a negative echo chamber that is inconsistent with the reality. And that is when you will decide to change that thought and stop talking about it. And then that echo chamber will stop.
So I think writing is a key point here. So whenever you talk about echo chambers, let's say you're active on Twitter and you're in an echo chamber because you follow like-minded people. I think writing helps make a clear distinction, because when you've written things down, things become concrete. So even if it's an echo chamber, it's easier to identify that, you know, hey, this was what I thought previously, this is what I think now, this is, well, you have a concrete log of events, and that makes it very easy to identify if you're in an echo chamber or not. And identification is, you know, is the key point. Once you have identified, I think it's easy to, you know, sort of go or, you know, seek other perspectives.
Yeah. So from what I, you know, hear is that it's okay to, you know, be in this echo chamber, but this is just one of these inputs. Like, you take this input and then you also, you know, talk to your friends, you talk to your mentors, you talk to, you know, other people in the world, and see if there is like some bias which is creeping in from, you know, internal bias keeping in. So I feel that's some way of, you know, I hope, Akash, we did some justice to your question, and feel free to, you know, talk about it more on the Slack group. And oh man, the questions are, there's four more questions. Let's just quickly wrap them up. This is a good one. Like, do you journal? Like, what time of the day do you journal? Do you have, this is Anirudh's question, by the way. Do you have like a retrospective for the day? Like, I know some people who do like an evening journal as well. So is that something which you'd like to, you know, talk a little bit about? Swapnil, Avi, anyone? I would just allow one person to answer this now.
Okay, I'll go.
In the interest of time.
Sure. Yeah. So, like I said before, daily does not work for me at all. So I do sort of monthly retrospectives. Weekly I try to do, but for me it's okay if I miss a week, but then monthly I definitely try to do, and there's an yearly retrospective as well. Daily retrospective is sort of, I found it like, you know, quite hard on myself. It gives you a very unrealistic, it puts like for me, it puts me under unrealistic pressure ki, hey, you know, you have to have done something to show for the day. And that is not, you know, that's just not how I work.
Fair enough. I think we'll, you know, stick to that right now. I'll take the next question, which is Pravdan's question. And instead of long-term goals, what about doable short-time goals for a month? Pravdan, I'm not sure if he's still there. Nope. I think he's left. He's left the room. But did you get a sense of his question? Like, I'm a little, you know, I'm not able to understand the justification, and it seems like we cannot get him right now. So
yeah.
So we'll skip this one. Yep. I hope, you know, that's cool, Pravdan, if you're still there. Sudarshan's question will be the last one, which is, do you guys use a framework of sort for journaling? Sudarshan, if you're there, would you like to? Share a little bit more about some context about this question.
Yeah. Can you guys hear me?
Yep.
Yeah. So basically, do you guys use a framework for journaling? Like, first section is what happened today. Second question is what did I feel about what happened today? Third is conclusion. Something very loosely based, something that supports something rigid, as well as like long form conscious writing, where you just jot down everything. Like, over the years, I'm assuming you would have formed some sort of template, and I just want to know what that template would be.
So, Swapnil, is it okay if I, you know,
yep,
take this one?
Yep. You
Avi?
Proactive.
Yep,
I have a template which I wanted to, you know, share in the session.
Yeah, you can share screen. Yeah.
Yep. So, this is kind of like, you know, like a very comprehensive kind of a template, and I did not want to share it because, you know, this the thing that we discussed before the call, that, you know, it could be a little bit overwhelming. But here's how I, you know, divide. This is like the first half of the day, like, you know, before the session, I just want to do like a grateful like a gratitude exercise, that's what it's called, and just think about what are the most important tasks for the day. I try to limit it to 3. And this is more of a intuition, like a visualizing exercise, like something. So, and this is the midday thing, wherein if something is coming up like that, I have to do some course, or, you know, there is something which needs to be done, but it's not urgent. Like, it doesn't require my attention right now. I can just, you know, put it down here. And this is more of just what's happening in the midst of, you know, my work day. Anything which is driving me crazy, any particular problem which is, you know, which I'm not able to figure out. And the last bit is, you know, the end of the day review. But let me be honest, Sudarshan, I am not, you know, doing this right now. I had this, you know, habit when I was, you know, in a more stable point in my life, I would say. So it depends, man. You can obviously, you know, I'll be sharing this template, and hopefully you can, you know, pick and choose the parts which work for you. You can, you know, add more questions. I, as you can see, I like my emojis. So yeah. Does this help?
Yeah, it does, kind of.
Yep. So you can be as creative as possible. So it's just, I would say, you know, don't, you know, make this, like, get into that mindset of having like that perfect journal entry. Like, there's no such thing as a perfect, you know, journal entry. It's very personal, and it's okay if you start off with just one or two questions. You can just start off with a gratitude journal for that, you know, for that matter. Cool. So I think we are, you know, just 15, 17 minutes, you know, past time. But this was, you know, a very interesting session. I hope I was able to hold some space in order to, you know, talk about this meta topic, and we were able to do some justice to it. And thank you, Swapnil, Avi, for, you know, holding space with me. I felt that, you know, your opinions really added a lot of, you know, value to this discussion. And for the rest of you, I would, you know, ask you to continue this discussion on either on Twitter, or you can join the Remote Indian Slack group if you know that kind of fits your goals or, you know, your mindset of sorts. So Swapnil, Avi, any closing thoughts before we close it?
Okay, you kind of put me on the spot here. I was not prepared for that. Avi, do you want to?
Okay. Oh man, sorry. No worries.
I just want to say, like, we go through a lot of books. We read books. We read podcasts. We watch great educational talks, but we don't do any justice to the material that we have learned right now. But I would like to say that after this call, just write one journal entry. It can be anything, any topic, and it can be on any app or on paper, anywhere you want, but just start. And if possible, try to do it regularly for some time so that you get a feel for it. And best of luck. I think journaling will change your life, and if you give it a chance, I think you will be thankful in a year's time.
I'll just piggyback on Avi here, ki if you take one takeaway from this, just, you know, go back, and if you didn't follow the prompt before, do it right now. You know, three of us are saying do it after the call, and you'll be really thankful. You know, your future self will thank you for this. Like, I cannot stress this enough. Like, journaling has been a life-changing thing for me. Yeah.
Awesome. Then we'll end on that note. Have a great evening, guys, and the rest of the weekend. See ya.
See you, everyone.